Hello, good morning. I'm so happy to be in person with you today. It's, I mean, the first time since 2 years that I get to be in front of such an audience. So thank you for having me today. And I apologize in advance, sorry for the French accent. I will try my best to speak more American English as much as I can. I'm Jean-François Bobier. I'm a partner and director from BCG. I'm based in Paris. I lead a global research team that we have on quantum computing. Some of our members are here today in the audience. And a few years back, BCG realized that the next wave of disruption is going to come from deep tech and quantum computing in particular. And we started a research group to determine, you know, what's going on and what will be the impact on our clients and how we should get prepared. And for us, it was obvious that the right way to do that was to look at the use cases, because the use case is really at the intersection of technology and the companies, and it's really a language that both can understand. And so very early on, we focused on what would be the use cases for our clients. We published a few reports. So I'm going to present you a new information that we didn't publish yet. So if you stay a little bit more. And what I'm going to do is start with, let's say, a little bit of context, and to say that why quantum computing is so important is that it goes in a growing market, which is an overall computing market. And I mean, it's staggering to imagine, but this year alone, $4 trillion were spent on classical computing. It's a lot of money, and the CAGR was 9%, and it has been consistently beating GDP forecasts for years and years and years. So it's definitely, as Marc Andreessen was saying, software is eating the world. We could say basically that computing is eating the world, and so we see more and more of these devices, these servers, and so on. And there is a sub-component of that, which is what is called big compute by companies like Hyperion. And big compute is the high performance computing that is dedicated to solve very complex problems. So for example, predicting crashes in automobile, modeling airflow in airplane design, or to determine well a reserve for analyzing seismic data in oil and gas. This is a large market already. It's $40 billion and it's growing, and it's growing a lot. It's 25%. And I can tell you, at my clients, you see more and more and more of these HPC clusters, because the need for simulation is not going down, but it's actually going up. And I think quantum computing comes in because actually, even if it's growing, it's still not enough. There are still problems that we can't solve today. So our friends from Hyperion, they did a survey, and they found these two numbers, 40 and 60%. I'm going to comment them, and just to tell you that I completely concur with these numbers, because we, talking to our clients, we find the same amount of, the same, let's say, split. So the first one is 40%, and this is the number of companies that do have complex problems, but they can't solve. They just can't solve it. The good example of that, for example, is in the aerospace sector. You can't do properly airflow modeling across a wing and air structure. It's not possible to do it accurately. It's a field called computational fluid dynamics. And right now, the best techniques basically decompose the wing and fuselage into polygons and try to solve the equations and try to anticipate what the airflow will look like. But the answer is you can't predict it properly. It's just not possible. And if you go to Boeing or if you go to Airbus, you will see that they still have today in 2021, they still have wind tunnels. Right, it seems old school, right, wind tunnels. So basically they put a model of the airframe and they pass wind upon the airframe. But even today in 2021, it's necessary. It's because some of these small turbulence that you can have in the tip of the wing that you will lose in a simulation can become big and big and big and can create chaotic interactions, and you will miss them even with the best computers out there. So 40% of companies have problems like that that you can't actually solve. So of course there are some workarounds. They try to get around the problem as much as they can. So with a combination of HPC and of course wind tunnels or Airbus, but it's not satisfactory. And another figure, which is I think even more important, 60% of companies, they have found a way to solve the problem. Right, so the problem is kind of solved at the company, but it's not satisfying enough. So I've got a good example of that. So in banks, it takes about 8 to 12 hours every day just to compute one figure, which is the value at risk, so the risk position of a bank. It takes an entire night to make this calculation, and I will spare you the details, but it's because the underlying assets are actually require some Monte Carlo simulation, and you need to go one by one and evaluate them one by one to get to the result. And it's not satisfying because if you are in a great depression like we were a decade ago, you don't want to wait the results to solve your risk problems. Or even in periods of high volatility that we had, like with COVID, you want to know where your risks are and how you can mitigate them. So it's not satisfying. You do have an answer, but it's not good enough. So there are a lot of needs, and this is where quantum computing obviously comes in. So we did a report in 2019 with Matt, and we updated this year, this July, and we predict the market for quantum computing to be between, you know, $450 to $850 billion by 2040. So it's pretty far off, and I will give you more close estimate by the end of the talk that are more useful than that. But I think what is interesting is how we looked at the use cases. So we think that there are four categories of them. The main one that we estimate to be $200 to $300 billion is simulation, and it comes to, let's say, the original aim that Feynman has when he proposed quantum computers, which is to simulate nature. And you find very interesting use cases, obviously drug discovery. We talked about computational fluid dynamics just earlier, so this is exactly simulating nature. We have chemistry use cases. We have energy use cases that are chemistry related. And funnily enough, but I think it's not so much a surprise, markets behave a little bit like nature. So the simulation capabilities of quantum computers can also be used to simulate markets. And so you find it in market simulation that I just mentioned about. So it's going to be a big market. And it's funny because it was really the first use case that Richard Feynman had in mind when he proposed quantum computing. The next one is around optimization. So we think that it will be a smaller use case, probably around $100 to $200 billion. And here we will leverage the capabilities of quantum computers to solve a vast category of NP-hard problems, such as the traveling salesman problem. So everyone in the audience, I guess, know the traveling salesman problem. So I'm a traveling salesman. I need to visit a few cities, but all of them have a distance between each of one of them. And actually, this is a NP-hard problem. So of course, if you have a few cities, you can solve it on classical computers. But if you have a lot of cities and you have a lot of calculations you need to do every day, then it becomes a problem you cannot solve on a classical computer. So here, you will find a lot of problems related to that. So basically, the idea is to, instead of getting some approximate answer or some local optimum answer, to get the optimal answer. And you see, we have a portfolio optimization, for example, in finance. So the idea is to execute For example, a trade. So you want to sell a portfolio of stock. What is the right sequence to sell them? That's actually an MPR problem. You have insurance. We just mentioned logistics. So the traveling salesman problem goes very well into how do I optimize a logistics network, right? And the same for aerospace. It's interesting because last week I was at the Deep Tech Week in Paris, and Safran, one of the plane engine makers, was saying that we could save something like 5% of aviation carbon emission if we were able to optimize flight routes, actually. So it's a lot, obviously. Next, and I think it's an interesting one, it's machine learning. And so I think, it was just mentioned by Bob Sorensen at IPN just earlier. We believe that quantum computers will be very good for machine learning with two different sets of capabilities. The first one will be to train classical neural network, but using quantum computing. And I will mention that use case later, but it's interesting because it's a very efficient way to use a quantum computer. You generate, for example, a set of very perfect data so you can train your machine learning algorithm on, and then you can use the classical machine learning algorithm to do the predictions. So that's one way to do it. So to train classical networks. And of course, there's another field, and I think Yordanis is there from QCWare, but I think a bunch of you are working on that, which is called QML, so quantum machine learning. And we are very hopeful that we could get better, faster predictions with less data using QML than classical neural networks. And thanks, for example, to entanglement and other properties from quantum computers. So this is a very active area. And actually, in our predictions, we think it will be equal to optimization, so close to $100 to $200 billion of value by 2040. So similar to optimization, so a big chunk. And we are very excited about the research that is going on there. And then the last one, obviously, we come with no surprise because Shor algorithm was a big thing. It will be around cryptography with use cases ranging across offense and defense. And we believe it's going to be an important area, obviously. So most of you are aware there will be a few stages to get to 2040. So currently we are in the NISQ era, and we could even split NISQ into two phases. So the phase that we are today is a phase that is before quantum advantage. And I just saw the Hyperion figures, and it's staggering to imagine that this year there was $500 million of revenues in the quantum computing market, and we are not still at the quantum advantage phase. So meaning that this market is research, is proof of concept, but it's not for real industrial practical applications yet. So it's in $500 million already for that. And then I hope, you know, next year or in 2 years or in 3 years at most, I think, will be in quantum advantage, so still NISQ, but we'll have practical use cases that actually serve a practical purpose and are better than classical computers. So that's really our hope. And our prediction is, as soon as probably 2023. And then there will be an important event called error correction. And when we will get to error correction, so we don't know when it's going to be. It's going to be between 25 and 2030. And there's a lot of debate on when we will have it. But that will open up more use cases because the noisy computers have two problems. The first one is that you can't, obviously you can't, there are some use cases where you need an exact answer, and it's not helpful to get an approximate answer. So the extreme example, obviously, is Shor algorithm. Either you got the good factors or not. Very simple. And then the second problem that you have in NISQ is that you cannot explore deep circuits. You are limited in shallow circuits. You know, a few dozen, a few hundred instructions, and it limits the depth of the algorithm you can do. And you need error correction to have much more deeper algorithm. So that will unlock much more value and much more market value for the industry. And of course, there will be more advances in scaling up by 2040. And then we'll hope that we will get the full market potential I just described earlier. So now I'm going to focus on the two next stages. So the current one we are at and the error correction, because they probably also overlap. And share with you our latest research. And so we did, so as I mentioned, the market we are in today is a research and proof of concept markets. So companies are really looking at what quantum computing can do, but they are not looking at yet at scaling it up, at deploying it, at implementing on real use cases. And we had the chance this year to talk to companies that to ask us, okay, we are doing this research, but once we have a quantum advantage somewhere, we need to get prepared now to put it in the company to really deploy it. That's a different game, because it's one thing to do a proof of concept. It's another thing to integrate it to our IT, to operate it 24/7, to do the change management with our users, and so on and so forth. So it's an entirely different thing. And they ask us to classify the use cases by, what would be more interesting for them to deploy now versus later. And we came up with this framework that I would like to share with you today. So basically, we classified the use cases in three buckets. And again, here, we take the mindset of a corporate buyer who will implement the use case at his company and what he will take him to make it happen. So the first category is what we have called here perfect. So the perfect use cases in this, so on the left-hand side, for them, there is actually an alternative in the classical world. There is a solution today, right? The only problem with this solution today is it's either a local optimum or a approximative solution or a slow solution. It has to satisfy one of these three criteria, and sometimes it can be both. It can be slow and imperfect. But you do have something. You do have something that actually works, that has been implemented, and that most of our clients that has been around for decades, right? And for example, I just mentioned it, but finding the optimal logistic route, right, is a typical use case that every day is solved. But we know it's not, because it's an MP complete problem, we know it's not the perfect route. Another example is I want to price a complex option, right? What banks will typically do is that because it's so difficult to explore all the possibilities that your option can play out, what they do is that they do a Monte Carlo simulation. So instead of solving the problem, it's not possible. They compute, they walk through the option 10,000, sometimes 100,000 times the option, and then they average out the result, and then that gives you the price of the option. Is it the right price? Probably not, but it's the only way we can do it today. So on a quantum computer, we could actually get their algorithms to get to the perfect result. Then the next category of problems are intractable problems. So what I mean by intractable problems, those are problems that you cannot solve today. The 40% that I just mentioned earlier. So there is no useful solution at scale right now. So of course, Shor is a good example. Obviously, I mean, unless the NSA and some spy agency have kept the secret, but today we can't factor a large integer into primes. It's not possible. Even on the best computer in the world, it's just not possible. Another intractable problem is I've got a large molecule. I want to know all its material properties, like how it will behave under pressure, what color it's going to have, and other characteristics. That is not just not possible on classical on current machines. And then there is a last category, which I think is exciting, because I mean it's up to our imagination. But those will be use cases that the unknown unknowns that we don't know yet. Right, but we will only be able to do them with quantum computers. So they won't replace anything we know of. They will be entirely new. Very interestingly, for example, recently there was a paper that was written to say, hey, maybe we could predict markets using random quantum walks. And that's an entirely new use case. Nobody thought about it. Nobody thought it was even a possibility. And so that's typically what we call a de novo use case. And just one figure I would like to share with you today. When you think about the figures I gave you earlier, remember the $450 to $850 billion market by 2040. We think that more than 50% of them will come from de novo use cases. So a lot of them are still to be found in a way. So one is could be in predictive markets, but there are a bunch of other ones that I think we will come up with. So now if we look at the decision criteria, the difficult part for the perfect use cases is that companies will compare them to what they have today. So what they will do is that they will do an ROI calculation, and what they will do is that they will do a differential ROI comparison. So they will look at the incremental value divided by the cost, obviously, of a quantum computing solution that we will get from implementing quantum computing compared to the current solution that we have. As I said, these solutions are not the best. They are not entirely satisfactory, but they are implemented and they work. So on the left-hand side, quantum computing does have some competition. And obviously, the more you go to the right-hand side, you don't have competition anymore, and then you are more traditional ROI computation for a company. So basically, the only hurdle you have to pass, if I may, is to have a better R, so value for the company, than I, which is the quantum computing cost, plus the change management cost, plus the IT implementation cost, because most of the time, these things need to be connected to some IT systems, right? So it's better to be on the right-hand side, to in the attractable or de novo, because you don't get compared to existing use cases, right? If you're on the left-hand side, you're competing with existing use cases. And my advice, and I'll deep dive on that, is if you go into those use cases, and it's very tempting, a lot of proof of concept are actually in that part. Please look for the ones that have the maximum differential value, because this is where you will get a decision from the corporate to implement it. And I think there are three reasons for, again, to look at these high-value use cases. So the first one, and I have to say it's a reality, we have to live with that, is that right now the quantum computing costs are way, way higher than the classical computing cost. Of course, I don't want to say we can compare the two, right? But for one hour of QPU right now, and for the next years, our estimate is that we're going to pay like $5,000 per hour, right? And just to give you a frame of comparison, a core per hour on the HPC side of things is more 5 cents, right? So you will get, I mean, quantum computing will individually get compared to that. And so on the high side, so the ROI will be less favorable, I would say. So we have to deal with that. And obviously, over time, we can expect the cost per hour to decrease as hardware gets better, more commoditized, and obviously at some point it will get more favorable also, the economics will get more favorable. But in the short term, we need to be aware of that difference. In the middle, obviously, the speaker before me from MIT was mentioning the quantum supremacy thing that happened when Google, you know, said we got quantum supremacy, and in 200 seconds we are able to do something that would take 10,000 years. And then IBM said, hey, wait a minute. Using the most expensive computer on Earth, so the Summit computer, so which is a $300 million computer, we can do the same thing that you said previously took 10,000 years in 2.5 days. So still, it's much better 200 seconds compared to 2.5 days. But what we can see is that every time quantum makes some progress, there are people on the classical side who improve their algorithms and are able somehow to catch up. I'm not saying it's one-to-one. Obviously, if the quantum supremacy, it's still much better to be on the quantum side. But I mean, we will see that competition going on. The next thing is that also AI is becoming a solid competitor to quantum. And I want to take a proof of AlphaFold. You probably heard of this algorithm from DeepMind, which is part of Google. And they are able, so using an RNA sequence, to determine how the protein that will be made will look like, so which is called protein folding. It was an intractable problem a few years ago. It was clearly in the middle part of my graph. And with AI, they made it somehow tractable. And we can think that some problems that are used to be in the intractable space, as AI progresses, will become more and more tractable. So the target that we need to aim for will move, and we need to be aware of that. And finally, and also this is why value is so important, one big enemy in corporations, and trust me, I'm fighting with them all the time, you will have to deal with is the big enemy is do nothing. Change management is a big issue at large corporates because again, changing an algorithm requires training, requires change management, requires changing the IT system, requires procuring consulting, integration, a contract with a quantum supplier, to make sure we have 24/7 provisions and stuff like that. And so the corporates are a very powerful machine to say no, actually, in my experience. So that's all of these three factors we argue, if I may, that we aim for the use cases that deliver the highest value because they will make all of these problems go away in discussions with corporates. And I'm just going to say one last thing I mentioned on that slide, which is if you combine the two first factors, it's interesting because I mentioned earlier, one interesting use case that we are predicting is that maybe a sweet spot for actually, instead of seeing AI as an enemy, but also as a market for quantum computing, is that we could use quantum computers to generate the data sets. So for example, for AlphaFold here, you need a lot of data sets to train these algorithms. Quantum computers can get you the right answers for chemical simulations, material properties, stuff like that. So you could imagine to use them to generate the data sets, but then you can use to train the classical neural network, and then you can use the classical neural network for the intractable problem. So it's not hopeless. And in that situation, you get better leverage for the quantum computing, and you can actually probably pay for the higher cost per minute in that situation. And finally, I promised I would deliver that, so here it is. So here are our predictions for the next years in terms of the use case that we see that will get traction in corporates based on the criteria I just mentioned earlier. So material design and drug discovery are, let's say, natural candidates. We already mentioned why. It's because they are intractable today. Imagine if you're able to design, for example, a new cement or let's say a new isolating material. I mean, you could patent it and you could be rich. And we think that material design is definitely one of the use cases that today is intractable. You can't get around going into labs, synthesizing the molecules and so on. You can't get around that. So it's definitely an intractable problem. Drug discovery, the same. And then the last one is financial services. And on financial services, it's interesting because it's more perfect type of use case. They do have solutions, but the R of the equations, you know, remember ROI, is much higher. So if you are able to really improve your transactions and to optimize your portfolios, the R will be high enough to compensate for the additional I from quantum computing. So financial services will be a right bet also, in my opinion. And with that, thank you for listening to me today. And I think I'm well over my time, so I probably don't have time for questions.